Welcome to our latest Freight Focus podcast. I'm Ken Adamo, Chief of Analytics at DAT, and we have a very special guest for this episode. We have Geoff Turner, who's President and CEO of Choptank Transport. Welcome, Geoff.
Hey, Ken. Thanks for having me on.
Glad to have you. So just real quick, for those not familiar with Choptank, do you mind giving us a high-level overview of what you guys are up to?
Yeah, no, that's a great question, and the foundation of our company was about 20 years ago. I came out of the poultry industry after I got out of college, so sort of learned the refrigerated business pretty well. And that was sort of where we got started. Our corporate office is in Maryland on the Eastern Shore. And for those not familiar with the area, there's a lot of poultry. Purdue Farms, a large poultry manufacturer, is close by. So we sort of learned the business moving a lot of poultry, and that sort of translated down over the years to, you know, being sort of really good at doing perishables. And that's sort of where we've gotten going on that. As the time has evolved, you know, we've adapted more and more technology into our business. When we first started, it was literally writing things on sort of a ledger board and billing from there. And as things evolved and as we've grown the company, you know, we've become more and more thirsty for better data, better analytics, better use of technology. And that's only grown as our customers continue just to want more and more. Right now, we're moving about 150,000 loads a year, primarily, you know, in that sweet spot of 700 to 800 mile length of haul. That's been our story. And I think, you know, we've really just gained the reputation of being really good at moving refrigerated freight.
Awesome. Yeah. We're going to put a pin in that technology and data piece. That's one of the reasons I was so excited to have you on. We're going to cover that a bit later, but, I wanted to start with a topic that I know has been beaten to death, but I'm really interested to hear your perspective on how COVID and the pandemic and sort of this supply chain turmoil has impacted both you, you know, at Choptank, as well as your customers' businesses.
Yeah, that's a great question, and you really can never beat that one too much, because, you know, it seems like even now we're still evolving day to day on things that we're seeing and are happening. But if you set the clock back to, you know, this time last year, you know, it was a huge challenge. We were tested as an organization. You know, we had over 400 people that all of a sudden we had to make the decision that you were working remote and making sure that our technologies were built out in a sense that that was, you know, capable of being done. Our IT teams did an excellent job of getting everybody remote. And we're thankful that we had, you know, made a lot of investments prior to COVID on our infrastructure, in the sense of, Microsoft Teams and all that stuff. And then, you know, how we had built redundant systems that were in the cloud. And so it made that move that much easier because of some of the stuff we had done prior to just merely on disaster planning. And that was really helpful. So the brokerage business is, you know, the ultimate collaboration, in my opinion. You know, you visit any of the larger brokers, and it typically most of the time you see open floors, and there's a lot of communication that has to happen. And learning to do that remote was a big challenge. And our folks really knocked it out of the park and did well with that. And it was great. You know, it was interesting because a lot of the tools we had in place, you know, like the Teams meetings and all, we had all that. We just weren't using it prior to. So now it seems like everybody it's just easy to, hey, let's do a Teams meeting. And what I like about that, even, you know, further down, is we've gotten our customers and our carriers into this now too. So we can just do a quick pickup meeting with our customers and say, hey, what's going on with this facility? And so it's opened our eyes to a lot more efficiencies that we can gain from this. So, you know, when you look back, it was tough, but we did learn a heck of a lot from this.
Yeah, I mean, it's a story we hear. There's a lot of similarities there. I think your point about it's felt like this has been a year you've been more in touch with your customers and partners and clients, even though you weren't physically, like, you weren't playing golf, but you were seeing them almost like virtually face to face more often. It's kind of a weird paradox.
Yeah, no, that's right. And it was just that much easier to have those little just pop-up meetings where, you know, typically, you know, in the past, you know, you'd try to coordinate a meeting and then you'd put together a bunch of slides and talk about how we're doing. Now it was just easy. Hey, tomorrow, can we get 15 minutes? We'll talk about this or that. And it made that stuff much easier, and it made it more sort of just the norm. And we like that ability to get that much closer to our customers and our carriers.
Yeah, for sure. So we're a little over a quarter into 21. I think most people, when the calendar flipped, expected things, even subconsciously, to maybe go back to normal a little bit, but that hasn't been the case. What are you seeing so far in calendar year 21, and what's your outlook for the rest of the year?
Yeah, it's certainly interesting in the sense that I don't know what back to normal is. You know, we were coming out of sort of a roller coaster as it was prior to COVID. So when you start thinking about the more fundamentals and you look at the freight market right now, you know, everybody is in that I see, all of our shippers and all of our carriers are really, really busy. And most of our carriers don't have any extra capacity. Most of our customers are looking for any capacity you can give them. So as we, you know, and you really think about it, you know, the economy truly isn't fully back online yet. So when you start thinking about when the economy sort of gets back to where we know it will be, you start thinking about people traveling again and getting out, and you think about the trillions of dollars of sort of stimulus money that's went into the economy. I don't really see many speed bumps ahead of us if as long as sort of COVID dies away a little bit. So it's going to be a robust freight market for some time, in my opinion.
So to add to that, we're seeing a lot of news about the chip shortage from Asia potentially delaying Class 8 truck orders hitting the road. Do you think that'll continue to provide pressure on capacity?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's a huge issue on the manufacturing side. And then, you know, we still can resurrect that conversation about drivers and the shortage of drivers, because I think it's, to your point, it's almost like a 1-2 punch there. You got the shortage of the truck supply, and you've got this still shortage of trained professional Class A drivers that's going to continue to plug the market until sometime that, you know, truck driving becomes sort of probably paid for what they're actually doing, the extent of the work that they're doing.
For sure. All right. So changing gears a little bit, you're a very prominent leader in the brokerage space. And I'd like to check in with folks and just sort of see how the pandemic and COVID has, if at all, altered your leadership style. How has it been? You know, what have been some challenges leading through COVID? And you know, what have you learned?
Yeah, I mean, I was joking to a group of our new hires the other day that I think I've aged 5 years this year. I think that's probably the biggest thing I can tell you. But, you know, our 20 years in business, we've always been incredibly committed to our employees. And even through the pandemic, you know, when we saw, you know, those March and April, when load counts, you know, sort of plummeted, we could have easily made some decisions to probably, you know, either downsize a little bit or whatever. But, you know, one thing I've learned over the years in this business, there's always ebbs and flows and cycles in the business. And if you're not positioning your company and your teams for when the market rebounds, you're sort of going to be behind the eight ball a little bit. So we've never backed down on our commitment to our folks and hiring. And so we've hired through the pandemic. We've continued to train through the pandemic. We've grown through the pandemic. So we're just really proud of that. And that comes from, you know, our ability of being, you know, a privately held company. So we can adapt and move and change at a rapid pace and really do what we can do to make our employees very good.
Yeah, I mean, your point, I just wanted to reinforce that not letting up when you see a little slowness. I was talking to a large leased on fleet, and they said they paused recruiting for like 6 weeks in March and April, and it completely bit them in the third and fourth quarters of 20 because they couldn't make up for lost time. They couldn't get enough trucks through, you know, their onboarding to get on the road to satisfy their customers.
Right. So, and you're absolutely right. Cause you can't sort of hit the switch on that, right? It's there's a process, there's a recruiting, there's a hiring, there's an onboarding, there's a training. So, you know, even shutting off for 6 weeks, that really crushes you for even longer than that. So, yeah. And we've been through those cycles before where we probably shouldn't have been hiring, But that's never been sort of our deal. We sort of know that on the other end of it, we'll position ourselves well to be successful.
So my last COVID question for you is a pretty simple one. What's one thing, if you had to pick, that you think will stick in a post-pandemic world as it pertains to our industry?
That's a great question. I think it's really reinforced the dependence on technology. It was easier. It was a little easier pre-COVID to sort of band-aid things or sort of piecemeal things. But I think if we didn't realize that we had a solid strategy to get through this, we probably wouldn't have been as successful. So I think making sure that your IT strategy is really strong. And when I talk about that, I'm talking about from all facets, how your employees interact with your software, how your customers and your carriers interact with your software, and giving them the tools that they need to be able to do their job successfully. I mean, that's what we've come into all this. We've had so many of our customers come to us relying on us to produce for them a wide variety of information, and it's not always the same. So our ability to be flexible and provide that to them has been sort of key. And I don't see that going away because, you know, we've gotten our customers hooked on it and they like it and it's helping them run a better operation.
Yeah, I agree. I think that between the data, the speed of data and relationships, those are the two huge takeaways from me that I think will, because 18 was a tough year, right? Mm-hmm. 18 was a busy year, low capacity. And I think a lot of relationships fractured in a way that they didn't necessarily in 20. So
yeah.
I think that was a big takeaway. From
yeah. And we always joke it, or not really joke, but we talk about, we thought we had it tough. You know, so many of our customers, especially the small to mid-sized ones, they didn't have much redundancy in place on how they handled all this. So, you know, we truly were their sort of savior in providing them what they needed because, you know, a lot of companies just didn't or weren't investing in this all along from the shipper side. And, you know, it made them that much more reliant on us as an organization.
Great. All right. I'm going to turn us away from COVID for a minute and talk more about data and analytics. And I promise I'm not our VP of sales, who you know very well. I'm not going to BS you just because you're sitting here. I really think Choptank is on the cutting edge of leveraging data and analytics as a strategic pillar, especially for like the size and number of shipments that you guys move. And I have to believe that comes kind of from a top-down approach and a top-down belief that data and analytics are a differentiator. Can you just talk a little bit about how you approach data and analytics as a strategy and deploy that throughout Choptank?
Yeah, no, that's a great question because, you know, looking back, the great thing for me and even my executive team is that we've all had the opportunity to be on the floor. You know, we've covered freight. I've sold to customers. I get all that. So we, in my opinion, have a sort of a leg up on sort of understanding what the customers need. And, you know, we started having customers probably about, it was in the 16-17 era, in that era. They started to ask us a lot of really tough data questions on, like, analyzing data and the way that they look at data. Because let's be honest, every shipper sort of has different, you know, KPIs on what they're trying to manage. And we as an organization have to be sort of adaptive on that in the sense that we can't say, oh, well, Choptank is going to provide you with this, this, and this, because that's not helping them accomplish their needs. So, you know, we looked at it as a strategy. Okay, let's be able to be a full service data shop for our customers where we can help them navigate through what they're trying to solve in their supply chain. So in 18, we brought on a data scientist who has helped us sort of carve out these unique data models that our customers are asking us for. And that's just become critical in our day-to-day operations now. We've got customers that are asking for rating automation and all this stuff that we're doing. And we just wouldn't have been able to do that without bringing on sort of the horsepower to get that done. So that's just been important for our growth. And we've actually, several of our customers introduced sort of this automated rating principle where we've got some process automation that just goes in and does it. And they don't have to go out to the market with 15 or 20 providers to try to figure out where they want to be. They can ping our database, shoots them back a rate, you know, does what it needs to do. and we can provide a lot of value. So yes, it was top down because I do think that's where the industry is going. And Ken, that's just sort of the beginning piece. It's also how we work on visibility, and there's all these little pieces that, you know, we've got some Fortune 500 customers that don't care about visibility. We've got some little customers that's all they care about. So it's just a wide variety of what the expectations are, and you have to be able to cater to those expectations.
Yeah, I mean, that's really interesting to hear, Geoff. And honestly, I've thoroughly enjoyed working with your data science folks, because I think a lot of people don't believe me when I say this, but they ask the tough questions. And I think the only way you build better products, especially on this side of the fence, is to get the tough questions, realize where you have gaps, and then, you know, build to improve that. So I wish more of our customers, quite frankly, were using the data to a level that they had these kind of zinger questions about. Yeah. Interpreting, you know, not just like the high level data, but like the nitty gritty.
Yeah, the days are gone of, you know, just, you know, knowing that a load from New Jersey to California should pay X. You know, like if you're not real time on, you know, day of the week, time of the day, holiday weeks, whatever, you've got to really make sure that your folks are building your models out to sort of satisfy all the different nuances in the marketplace right now.
You know, one of the things I dealt with when I was formerly at a large asset light shop is the more reliance you put on these rating algorithms, the more importance it is that, I mean, because mistakes can grow rapidly because you're not watching every single shipment, right? You're relying on the algorithm to sort of do its thing, and sometimes it could be hundreds of shipments before you catch, you know, pricing too low or too high on a specific lane. And it's a lot of trust that you put into those teams and the data.
It is. And, you know, just my advice to folks is don't turn that on a Friday afternoon and come back in Monday morning.
Sounds like you have a little experience in that area.
And we, you know, again, it's like anything, this, but we learned the hard way on some stuff, but, that gave us the ability to continue to refine the models. And to your point on a data scientist, you know, when they start whipping out the scattered diagrams of where the rates have all fell and all that stuff, it really starts to open up like, wow, there really is a correlation there. And wow, never looked at it that way. And so it really starts to get those bells, you know, the thoughts sort of going with our folks and sort of knowing that there is a better way to do this.
Well, I want to ask, right? So this isn't like a data science kind of dorky question about how you distinguish signal from noise and what makes good data, right? Because you as a buyer, right, as a decision maker within your large company, are probably constantly barraged with new data products, new tools, new technology. And, you know, how do you think about signal from noise? And what is worthy of like your time to evaluate? And then ultimately what data adds to your competitive prowess around data and analytics?
Number one, our running joke in the organization, we've never had a bad demo. Okay. That's always our thing. That's probably not new to Choptank, but you know, every software, when you first look at it, looks really cool. And you think, oh wow, this can accommodate our needs and all that. But when you really start getting into the nitty gritty and looking at number one, what are your people relying on? What are your people saying, hey, I get the most reliable rates from X, or, you know, where do you see the most data points? And, you know, one of the things that we've noticed is that when we have lanes that, you know, either we don't have good data on, or even, you know, some of the data providers don't have good data on, it's really nice that, you know, some of the providers can really give you a good explanation on, okay, here's how we calculate that rate. You know, it's, you know, we go out zone one or two or three or this, that, some formula. And to your point on data scientist, if you just tell, if it's some sort of proprietary or something, our guys freak out about that, because it's like there's got to be some mathematical basis for how you're determining rates. So over time, you know, we that's an important question for us is like, when you have out of market stuff, or you have areas where you have limited data, how do you produce sort of a good rate for our team to run with? And, you know, that's always a great question for us, but it really goes down to, you know, how can we get a good, accurate rate as fast as we can, and something that our folks rely on. And we've been comfortable with how we've gotten that from DAT.
I was always worried about as a leader in the data science and pricing teams in my prior life, it's okay if you don't have sufficient information on a lane or an area. What isn't okay is if you're telling me that you do and you really don't.
Right.
That's the widow maker, if you will, when you're building out spot pricing or contract pricing. If you're making assumptions based on sketchy data and you know it's sort of sketchy,
right?
That's one thing.
Yeah.
If you're making assumptions based on data, assuming it's good, that's a whole different ball of wax, and it can have major and what you do more so, I mean, the money's one thing. You're very concerned, I'm sure, with your margins. But it's like that loss of faith. And like, I found that the change management required to bring some of these more seasoned brokers along to pricing algorithms and automated rating, you breach that trust when your model drifts a bit. And that's sometimes just as valuable.
Absolutely. And it also, and even on the flip side, even from our customer perspective, we've had some challenging conversations with customers on some of the automation we've done, because sometimes it to your point, if there's not reliable data behind it, it throws out some crazy rate, and our customer's like, I hope you weren't trying to rate that at, you know, 8x market or something, like, you know. So again, it goes back to, you know, having that that delta between the top and bottom is really, really tight. And to your point, from an internal perspective, there's nothing worse than burns out our folks if, you know, the automation that's supposed to be highly accurate books 100 loads at a loss. You know, that's not going to make any of our folks real happy. So, you know, being able to rely on that is really, really important.
Those are the days I'd look out my window and make sure that the ops manager's left before I walked to my car. I think we've all had those.
Yes.
But hey, Geoff, so I want to end on my selfish question that I like to ask everyone, because it's like a personal thing for me, is what big things do you see coming down the pike for our industry over the next few years? Thinking 3 to 5 years out, like what are you watching as a leader in our industry?
Yeah, I mean, I think everybody's got on their mind, you know, autonomous trucks. You know, you saw that, you know, Too Simple went public this week or last week, whenever it was. And, you know, I think there's a lot of thought around that. So I think that's going to be interesting to see how that shapes up. I don't know that that's going to be in our 3 to 5 year window. And even if it is, I don't know that it would be on many lanes that would affect much. I could see it being run between Phoenix and LA or Phoenix and Vegas, or where it's a little more easy to control. But majority of our freight is east of the Mississippi and in the Northeast. So I don't see many autonomous trucks running in the Northeast anytime soon, in my opinion. But I do think, you know, that, you know, one of the big things I see in the near term is, and I think a lot of people working on this, but it's how we become even more connected to our carriers. As our organization, we've got to get better at that, because, you know, this one-off sort of, you know, mobile tracking is it works, but it's very difficult. And I think it puts an unneeded wrinkle in sometimes in the relationships with the carrier. So I think the more that we can build that trust level with carriers that, hey, we'd love to hook into your ELDs, we'd love to share that this information to be just for one load. There's not going to be any global thing where we're going to be tracking your trucks all the time or anything like that. But we got to figure out how to become more connected with our carriers in that sense. Now, on the flip side, on the customer side, what I've seen, and to back up to your question on the pandemic, what we have seen is we've seen more customers ready to adapt technology, meaning, you know, it was not unheard of even a year ago. We had large customers that still tried to fax us orders. You know, that's still around. But after all this, when the traffic managers went to work from home and all that, they didn't have fax machines, right? So they had to start adapting. So we're starting to see more and more of that, from the shippers being more ready to adapt some sort of TMS, some sort of TMS with very robust APIs, so we can all talk to each other. And the last thing I would leave you with that I don't think is going to go anywhere 3, 5, 10, 20 years. This business is still going to be a relationship driven business. We can bolt on all the technology we want to make things easier, make things better, but it's always going to boil down to good relationships with your customers and your carriers. And I think that is still going to drive a lot of decisions moving 3, 5, 10 years and beyond.
I couldn't agree more. You know, whether I've worked in data science, pricing, I've worked closely with sales teams, I've tried to make sure we're as close to the customer as, you know, physically possible, you know, during COVID. But, you know, I want my data scientists, I want my data analysts out talking to customers, because the better we understand their problems, the better we can build solutions to those problems. Right? We don't understand them in the abstract on a piece of paper or a, you know, a spreadsheet. I want to understand, what's a data scientist doing 20% more work than he or she has to ingest our data? Because that could be the difference between going with us or someone else.
Right. Right. And you're spot on. And being able to listen to them on that, because as I said earlier, we've got customers that look at things by, you know, rate per mile, cost per pound, cost per hundredweight. I mean, we've got customers that look at things all kinds of different ways. And to your point, if you're not listening, you're not getting out and talking to them, you're never going to know that. And you're just going to send them a platter of data that they could probably throw in the trash because it's not going to meet their needs.
For sure. Well, hey, Geoff, we're coming up on time. I wanted to thank you so much for joining us. Once things do thaw out, we need to get out and hit the links.
Yes, be great.
Play some golf, let Weaver sandbag us a bit.
he's pretty good at that.
Yeah, he is for sure. But again, thank you to you. Thanks to Choptank. And again, good luck out there through the rest of 21 trying to get those loads covered.
Very good. Thanks, Ken. Thanks for having me.
Thanks for tuning in to this episode of our Freight Focus podcast, and thanks again to our guest, Geoff Turner from Choptank Transport. Please check out our other content, our earlier Freight Focus podcast, as well as our weekly DAT IQ market update and our Freightvine podcast with Dr. Chris Kaplis. Thanks again.